Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City Turbines, where we are about to complete the second last step on building this Arenda 14 turbojet engine for a Sabre jet, CL-13 Canadair Sabre, which is a Canadian license built version of the F-86F Sabre. It's awesome. If you want to follow on every step of the way, from taking the parts out of storage to cleaning, inspecting, reconditioning, re-inspecting, and painting or recoating, and then reassembling the whole thing, go to the Patreon page, patreon.com/agentJZ, whatever you like. Yeah. So this is it, the Arenda turbojet. We've got one thing to put on. The main fuel control goes right there. And then the last step will be to test it. So we'll be doing that shortly. A couple days ago, I got a question from a friendly viewer named Svignesh2000. Svignesh2000. And he's responding to a video I made a couple years ago called Turbine Engines, A Closer Look, The Air Starter. The air starter is a very common one we use in our test cell. And he says, I would like to ask you for a video on hydraulic starter system. But what we're going to do, I'm inspired to do a little bit more than that. Okay, so we start a variety of engines in our test cell. And I've shown a few of the mechanisms. But what we're going to do now, I'm going to try to do this with the help of our friendly whiteboard. We're going to try to go through every possible way it is to start a jet engine. A jet engine, a gas turbine engine, the two are the same thing with the difference of one single component. And I'll show you that right now with the help of my diagrams. Hang on. All right, so we've got some nice color pictures here with the best and simplest diagram I have is from a GE textbook for technicians. Let's see if I can hold it well. All right, so we've got at the top here, a gas turbine engine. I suppose you could call it an engine. It's actually technically known as a gas generator, okay? Down here is a jet engine, and they're the same thing. Yes. Now it does say that there's an exhaust duct on there. There's an exhaust duct here as well. There, I'm doing this backwards with my left hand. Exhaust goes out there, exhaust goes out here. So they got an exhaust pipe, but that's a meaningless component because it's just a pipe. The most important thing that turns a gas generator into a jet engine or a turbojet, the simplest of jet engines, is that little narrowing there, the gas acceleration nozzle. What do they call it? They call it, I guess the engineers back in the day would have called it a gas jet nozzle. It's been shortened to jet nozzle, and that's why these things are called jet engines. They are gas jet engines or exhaust gas jet engines. That's where the word came from. So, gas generator, jet engine. Very simple, very, very simple. That is the difference. Without the nozzle, it's technically known as a gas generator. All right, so what I want to do today is I want to list and then hopefully show some footage of, from old videos or new footage, of every single way to start a gas turbine engine. And before I do that, I've got to erase it, erase the whiteboard. But before we erase it, I got another comment, a few comments recently about the PT6. This is the Pratt & Whitney PT6 in vastly oversimplified form. PT6B, actually. And those people call it a reverse flow engine. Now, that depends upon whether you're an airplane guy or an engine guy. Because you could say that it's mounted in the aircraft backwards to what you would expect. It's actually mounted the correct way in the aircraft, but people call it backwards because it's different from other engines. Sure, you could say it's backwards, but reverse airflow, the air comes in the air inlet, travels through the duct to three stages of axial compressor into a centrifugal compressor, gets discharged around a corner and another corner into the combustion chamber, combustion area, the combustor. I don't usually like to call it a combustion chamber because it isn't a chamber, it's an open pipe at both ends. How that's a chamber, I don't know. Anyway, it enters at the high pressure end of the combustor. It's mixed with fuel. The fuel nozzle is not illustrated, it's right there. It flows to what I call the back or the discharge of the combustor. It gets massively heated and accelerated, makes another corner, goes to the high pressure of the compressor turbine, it's called, right there, which makes this turn. Goes through the lower pressure of the power turbine, which there's no connection there. This drives the propeller at the front of the airplane, and then it gets exhausted out the exhaust duct. So to an engine guy, the air goes the right way. It goes the correct way. Reverse, forward. People call it a reverse airflow instead of forward. That's not the opposite of reverse to me in this situation. Anyway, it goes the normal way into the front of the compressor, out the back of the compressor, into the front of the combustor, out the back of the combustor, into the front of the turbines, out the back of the turbines, and out the exhaust. Now you could say that these 90 degree corners, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, even 8. 8 90 degree corners. Well, that's kind of messed up, isn't it? Doesn't that mess with efficiency? And not really. Air's really good at going around corners if it's properly managed. The PT6 is one of the most popular and most produced and most reliable gas turbine engines ever in history. It's amazing. So really, there's no real loss of efficiency, but you could say, sure, the airflow reverses in direction there and there. Yeah, it does. Why does it do that? Well, they made the whole thing shorter so they could get these turbines here instead of back here, and then you'd have a great big long shaft for the compressor. So they want a nice short compressor shaft and a nice short power turbine shaft so that short, stiff shafts are less likely to wobble or bow or imbalance or whatever, fatigue. That's why they did the engine that way, otherwise it would be much longer. And it'd also be more difficult to fit into the front of small aircraft. Anyway, if you want to call this reverse flow, that's fine. But when you say it's got reverse airflow, to me that means something different. That means reverse airflow happens in a compressor when it stalls and the air goes out the front. The compressor stops working. The turbines, they never stall. A jet engine or an airliner engine stall means a compressor stall. The compression breaks down and the air surges forward and then recovers. But when it surges forward and recovers, it happens with a big flame out the back. That's reverse airflow. That means airflow going in the wrong direction. So instead of saying reverse and forward airflow, we should say correct and incorrect airflow. The airflow in this engine at all points is correct. It's not incorrect. It's not reverse airflow. Anyway, that's my little rant about the PT6. A lovely engine, everybody loves it, and now we're gonna erase the board and get to the real subject of the video. Okay, it's whenever I work with this whiteboard, I realize how hard the job it is for teachers. I'm not a teacher, but I'm gonna write stuff down and see how it goes. First, we're gonna start with the three basic large categories. So let's go with electric first, because most modern gas turbine engines, I don't know about the biggest ones, but things like on the 787 and the PT6, for example, and a lot of engines. We're going to go with electric. Electric starting, an electric motor, and that can be divided into several categories. Let's say, how am I going to do this? Go AC and DC. Well, that's easy, wasn't it? Okay, so also there's various voltages with AC and DC. This one is a 28 volt giant electric motor. It's very heavy and it's a direct drive, which means that the motor connects directly to the main shaft of the engine, and there's no reduction gearing, no transfer gearbox. It's just straight on there. So it's got to be a big motor. And it's also the mass of the central core isn't too big, because that's a huge job. You're turning the whole thing up to starting RPM. So there's DC direct drive. What are we going to say? Direct. We'll do that. And then through a gearbox. And that can be advantageous because... hang on. Well, you can see it on here. This is the central shaft. There's a gearbox up here and a gearbox down there for the oil pumps. Some industrial arendas, they have a reduction gearbox down here and an electric motor to start the engine. Because this part of the engine is in the air inlet duct, and this can be outside of it if you really want to, or it's just easier to access this. It's another way to do things. Anyway, this is a very old engine from the 1940s, and it doesn't have an accessory gearbox. Well, it does, up front here, but it doesn't have what they call a transfer gearbox. In other words, the main shaft turns at whatever shaft speed it turns at, and it directly goes into a gearbox with different gears and ratios to turn all the different accessories right on it. But it's also right in the front of the engine. This is an oversimplified diagram that doesn't include it. This is an interesting cutaway because it doesn't show the gearbox. This is a fairly modern airliner engine. Here's an RB211, which was developed in the 70s. It is a three-spool engine, and the center shaft, all this stuff in red, is what the gearbox is keyed to, because it's basically the fuel-burning core of the engine. So there's a transfer gearbox. Actually, this one has one there and one here. So that's transfer, intermediate, and this is the accessory gearbox. All the fuel pumps, generators, oil pumps, all that stuff is down in here. And so there's this radial drive shaft. Now, the starter is going to be down here too, because then the starter doesn't have to be deep inside the engine or right in front where it get in the way of the airflow. This is the way most engines are now. I think all engines have a transfer gearbox and an accessory gearbox and a radial drive shaft. This one's slightly unusual because the radial drive shaft doesn't go straight down. It comes forward at an angle. That's all great fun. This is the Arenda, and it's one of the first engines that had a transfer gearbox up front and a radial drive shaft going down and up. Okay, so we still have more categories for DC. Well, we're not going to mention the, are we? The different voltages? Leave that out for now. Not so much, we'd have to duplicate this division on each one, but I'm just going to have it coming out here. And that is a start cart from a generator, from a literally, usually a piston engine turning a generator, like a welder supplying current. So what would we call that? We would call that generator, you're sure. Generator supplied. And we can even break that down into a lot of times at the airport, you'll see a smaller airliner that has there's a machine they wheel out there on rubber tires. It's, you know, like an ice cream cart size thing. And it's a little diesel engine that runs a generator that supplies power to the aircraft, also supplies power to start the engines. Okay, that's usually DC. AC to run the power in the aircraft and DC for the engines. And there's another way to do it, and that is by battery. Okay. So why don't those small airliners just crank it up on the battery like a car? Because it takes too much current and it would take a lot of batteries. And if you need 800 pounds of batteries or 500 pounds of batteries to start the engines on your little airliner, well, that's two passengers right there. So that's two less passengers you can carry. You've got to carry that battery around all the time only to use it to start. Much like an Indy car, you don't want to have the battery on board. They don't even have the starter on board. The guy shows up with a cart, sticks it on the engine, starts it, takes away the starter motor and the batteries. The aircraft has the starter on the engine, but the batteries are too large to carry around all the time. So typically this is only used in emergencies, rare cases, but the battery could be off the aircraft. There are certain start carts that you wheel up to an aircraft to start it, particularly with small commercial aircraft, not the big airliners, where it doesn't have a generator on board. It's just a big cart with batteries and it starts the aircraft. Now, I have footage of this engine starts with a diesel powered start cart. We have footage of that. I'll try to include footage of all these things. We have footage of an Avon, a Rolls-Royce Avon, electric start. It was 132 volt DC. So this is 28 volts DC. The Avon was 132 volts DC. And what's 132 volts? It is 11 car batteries in series. And I think I have footage of that somewhere. Okay, so AC is just a great big AC motor. That's going to be either direct or gearbox. Typically, this is for an industrial situation because any big building, any big industrial building is hooked up to the power grid. You've got lots of power there, so you get yourself a 50 horsepower or 100 horsepower electric motor, and you put it right on the front here, and it just stays there. And the weight of the whole thing doesn't matter, so that's why you've got a gigantic electric motor. And wall mains, switch them on and it goes. And the advantage of that is that starter motor can power that engine up to starting RPM easily, and it can keep it there. Let's say you wanted to wash the engine and then dry it out. Just flip that starter on for 2 or 3 minutes, no big deal. The aircraft starters, they're big and heavy things, but they're as small as they can be. This one has a maximum service interval of 45 seconds. If you run it more than 45 seconds, it gets too hot. So it is 90 pounds. It's a beast, but it's as light as it can be possibly made. If it was meant to be running continuously, a 90 horsepower electric motor would be much larger than this, with a much bigger casing and cooling fins and the whole thing. So way too heavy to put in an airplane. Remember, this is part of the weight of the aircraft when it's flying around. Anyway, those are the two electric ones, the many electric ones I can think of. Let's go next to another very common which is air or gas. Air. Okay, hang on, I got to think about a few things here. Okay, the most common one, and the video that this question was a response to is for air turbine starters. So I'm going to call it, it's technically a gas turbine, but we're going to call it an air turbine because gas turbine usually makes me think of combustion gases, and we're going to get to that. So the direct and gearbox, that applies to all of them, I guess. This is going to be a lot of things. Air turbine starter. Okay, they all have reduction gearing. Yep. They're not direct drive. The reduction gearing is directly part of the starter. Okay, then we have a gas turbine. Nope, we're going to go another air one before that. Sorry, made a mess here. We're going to go air impingement. I don't need to repeat the word air, but that's just the name that it's called by. Impingement. Okay, let's call this, I don't know, there's amateur. Amateur and industrial, I suppose. Yeah. Industrial. Okay, the air impingement starter is something we have never used. We have the pieces, and I have shown that before in a video. I'll try to have that footage here somewhere. What it is it's the air turbine starter. First, we're going to go back to the beginning. This is about 25 PSI. Okay, 25 PSI. The air turbine starter. The air impingement starter is going to be using 100 or 150 PSI. It's higher pressure. Let's just say 125 PSI. We'll split the difference. It uses air from a source. Typically, these engines were on large ships, aircraft carriers, actually. And an aircraft carrier has a lot of machinery. It's got everything you need. Electricity, water, food, sewage, the whole thing. And compressed air. So shop air, a very large amount of shop air is fed to a manifold that looks, it starts off wider and it gets smaller and smaller and smaller as it feeds about five or six, I think it's five little arms into the turbine case of the engine. So it's direct impingement or air impingement. The air goes through those little pipes in the turbine case, and they directly hit the turbine blades the way that the exhaust gases would if the engine is running. And so they force the whole thing to start turning. It takes a lot of high pressure air to get that thing going. And once the engine's at starting RPM, you hit it. You give it fuel and ignition and away it goes. So back when I was out in the back 40 looking at other engines and other starters and this and that and here and there, I did find, laying in the stainless steel scrap pile, which we were notorious for not clearing it because there's so much cool stuff there. And sometimes I hide stuff so it doesn't get scrapped and melted down. One of those things was one of several air impingement starter manifolds. It's got an inlet and the other end is blocked with seven little outlets. And I believe the reason that it looks like this and not just straight into little pads is because, well, how would you do up the bolts if they were underneath here? And also to make the whole thing smaller in diameter, maybe. But these parts only go on one type of engine. And it's from an LM1500-PB104. And the PB104 was used as a power generating unit, an electrical power generating unit on American aircraft carriers back in the day, maybe still now, but I doubt it because they'd use a newer engine. Anyway, the exhaust would generate steam and the rotational power would turn a generator, and they would start the engines with the most reliable source, reliable method they could. Air impingement has only one moving part. We're going to look at it in a second. These connect directly to the turbine case, and the air blows directly on the turbine blades, which normally in the engine is going to be, depending on the stage of the turbine, I think it's the second stage, going to see about 100 PSI. So 100 PSI is roughly around the pressure of shop air. So any air compressor system that's designed for other things could have a large reservoir and supply this. So that's the input flange of the manifold, the flugelhorn, and the this is the supply from the valve. This is the only moving part in the whole system. When you supply air to this, it's going to push, let's see, where are we in the light? It's going to push that thing open and allow air to go. And when the supply is shut off and the engine's running, you'll get roughly 100 PSI-ish, whatever, at maximum power. But at starting, you'll get like 3 or 4 PSI. But that's enough to close this and not allow air to go back out. Super cool. And I wanted to show you one really cool detail. We'll have to change the camera view in just a second. Okay, let's zoom in here carefully. Can we see that? Hang on. Oh, there we go. It says duct assembly, impingement starting, blah, 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 Burbank, California. So you don't see that very often. Made in California, made in Los Angeles. Ah, yes, the 1950s and 1960s. That's when you see a lot of aerospace parts of the highest quality available, made in USA, made in New Jersey, made in New York City. No, it says made in New York. Made in California, made in Burbank, made in Texas sometimes. Lots of made in America stamps, which is really cool to see because you don't see that too much anymore. But I'm lucky to work with old stuff. Anyway, this is an air impingement starter and it is really cool. It's very rare. And I think I'm going to clean this up a little bit. You can see that I tried to clean it a bit there. So there's some shiny bits. It brushes off quite nicely because everything's made of stainless steel. And I might just hang this on the wall. It's too bad that they didn't come in right and left hand engines, because then you'd have a set of antlers, but they only go one way. And yeah, that's a tidbit for another day, but a lot of people, some people that I have talked to, they say that the engines in, say, an FA-18 or even an F-22 go the opposite way, and that is absolutely not true. They both go the same way. So yeah. Air impingement starting. Rare and strange and super cool. It's interesting. We have the parts. We've taken what we do for industrial engines is we block those ports off in the turbine case and we don't use the whole system. So that's pretty cool. And then the amateur air impingement starting technique is very crude. Typically a dude. Usually a dude, not a girl, but I'm not excluding that, will build a turbine engine out of a turbocharger. They're all quite ingenious and interesting. And he'll get it going, not with an electric starter or anything else. Take a leaf blower that blows air, just shove it right in the intake of the engine and just blow the whole thing. Just get it going. That does work, but on any sort of a larger engine or industrial scale, it's not really... The closest thing to it is the air impingement starter. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Okay. Ah. So then we've got gas. I'm just going to call it, we'll call it a combustion gas. Combustion gas. Combustion gas. Okay. So we got a cartridge start. Cartridge start. Okay, I just realized this is going to be a longer video than I thought, and I hope you don't mind that, but we're going to cover everything. So a combustion gas starter, cartridge start, is usually the only one we've encountered, and I do have some footage of it when I didn't understand what it was, which will be funny. It's an air turbine starter with an extra inlet, and that is the combustion air cartridge starter. This is actually a combination. Let's see if I can turn it without flipping it over. It's got an inlet here for pressurized air of about, it says up to 75 PSI in the manual, but we're gonna feed it about 30. And here is where a big canister fits on. The engine we got did not have the canister. It's the outer case, I suppose, where inside is a big coffee can size charge of gunpowder, rocket fuel, whatever. It's halfway between rocket fuel and gunpowder. It doesn't explode, but it burns quickly and makes a lot of gas. It's a gas generator. And through that little hole, that little tiny hole, it's about 5/8, it feeds this pipe here that goes down into the turbine housing, the turbine inlet housing, which you'll see is shared with this. Same thing. This is a, where is it? Can you see that? Bit of glare, sorry about that. Trying to get rid of the glare. Okay. It's a starter engine cartridge pneumatic. Now, is that a pneumatic cartridge starter or a starter that can use either cartridges or pneumatic? I'm gonna go with choice B. And look at that, eh? Made in the USA. Back then, everything was made in the USA. Okay, so combustion gas, I'm just gonna say turbine because it's a little complicated. It's actually a small turbine engine, a small gas generator, a small jet engine without a nozzle. It's typically about 100 pounds. It's roughly about 80 to 100 horsepower. There's two ways to do it. One of them is the exhaust of that small, complete little turbine engine feeds into an air turbine starter. That would work. It's designed for higher temperatures and it starts the engine. Another way to do it is, let's see how complicated this gets. Let me go exhaust gas and then mechanical. And that is, there's an engine out there called a JFS-100. It's a complete little gas turbine engine, totally complete, and its exhaust goes through a power turbine with a reduction gear, and the output is a geared shaft. So it behaves exactly like anything else here. Behaves like an electric motor or an air turbine starter. Its output is a shaft with splines on it, and it plugs into the front of the engine. So you've got a little battery that starts your JFS-100, which is a 100 horsepower turbo shaft engine. And it spins up and it starts all automatically. And now you've got does it have a throttle or is it, I think it's automatic. It just goes like a lawnmower right to full throttle, governed at a speed. And now you've got 100 horsepower on a shaft to turn something. And if it's turning nothing, it will reach its output speed and back off the fuel and just, you know, it'll keep that speed. And if it's hooked to a big load, it'll give it more gas to keep that speed or get that speed up there. It's a great little thing. That's a combustion gas mechanical output starter, which is actually a little gas turbine engine. And it starts with a even smaller battery and electric motor. It's funny that. Okay, we're out here in another storage area, and this is your little baby 90 horsepower gas turbine engine known as the JFS-100. This one has had a few problems. Let's see if this shows up in the light. I'll have to turn it around. Hang on. Okay, this is the inlet. We've just turned it around. This is your little engine. I'll pick it up in a minute. It's not very heavy. And this one has had an accident, an overheat, and the turbine blades have had a bad rub and have lost material off the end. It's mangled. Okay, those are the turbine nozzle guide vanes right in front of it, and these are the turbine blades that have broken and been eaten away off of there. Anyway, this whole thing connects to right there. This is the power turbine. So the exhaust gas is from the gas generator, which is that could be a jet engine, but there's no nozzle on it. So it's a gas generator. Feeds into here, turns it that way, yeah, very smooth. And the exhaust comes out here.
And what that does is it turns. Let's see if that does turn. Oh, look at that. There's a reduction gearing in there. Hang on, right there. So you're turning the turbine really quickly, and that turns quite slowly with a massive amount of torque, and that goes into the gearbox to start the engine. So that combined with that, let's put them together. Okay, so that combined with that makes it a small turboshaft engine with the output a mechanical drive of great torque, moderate speed to start a bigger engine. Now the question is, how do we start that? Well, just a second. Alright, we've put this up on its end so we can see the bottom. The bottom right there, there's one big bolt and a circular spigot and a, you can't really see it, but a shaft goes up there, and the shaft comes out of this thing. There's that one bolt hole. Shaft goes into there, and this is this little thing. There's my hand. This little thing is a electric starter motor. Just to show you, let me see if I can do this with my left hand. What does that say? It says motor DC starter. And that's the starter motor for the little engine that acts as a starter motor for the big engine. Okay, just for fun, I went and found the drive shaft. That's it. Okay, so that little thing, this transmits the torque from the starter motor to the starter motor to start the engine that acts as a starter motor for the big engine. There it is, it's engaged. Cool. Oh, sorry. That's where it is. It goes right in there. Left hand through the camera with a lag. It's really, it's hard to coordinate your actions. Yeah, your JFS 100, cute little thing. All you hobbyists, you want one of these things. Although, it's got a probably a 5 minute maximum run time. There's no oil pump in there. It's only splash lubricated. And you'd need to devise some kind of a circulating oil system to run it for any length of time. Okay, I put it back and I forgot to pick it up for you. But the gas generator, the power turbine, and the starter all together probably weighs a little less than 100 pounds. So 90 horsepower, 90 pounds maybe, something like that. It's slightly less power dense than an Allison 250 helicopter engine, which runs you, for the old ones, 400 horsepower and 150 pounds. Okay, I had to back up a little bit there to the beginning of our list of air turbine starters, because maybe not modern airliners, but some of the bigger ones, and certainly older airliners from the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. The air turbine starter on each engine can be supplied by its air from a variety of sources. Usually it's from an APU, which is on board the airliner. An APU is very similar to one of these things, a gas turbine engine starter, because an APU is a very small 100 horsepower, 100 to 200 horsepower gas turbine engine that starts with a battery, and it doesn't take a big battery because it's a relatively small mass to get going. So you can jump on your, let's say, 727 or DC-8 or MD-80 or MD-90. One of those planes, you know, they're from the 70s and 80s. You push a button and the APU starts, no big deal. And it's usually pretty automatic. It's a very tough engine. It's not the most efficient engine in the world, but it's almost guaranteed to start, and it's guaranteed to keep running. It's a very tough little thing. So you start the APU, and it's got a valve on it that it can bleed off air at a sufficient rate and pressure to start one of the big engines. So all the plumbing is all there in the plane. Just valves open and engines go. Engines start. Now, the same engines with a few more bits of plumbing and valves, instead of the APU starting number one engine, number two engine, number three engine, and number four engine, you can start number one engine on the APU, which maybe is kind of a just barely thing, and then number one engine's running, and it's a much bigger thing. It's got a huge amount of bleed air. Just that one can cross bleed the start to
two, three, and four in, let's say, a 747. And that's why I've got cross bleed here. So those engines can all start each other. They each have a starter. They've got interconnecting pipes and valves that can let any one start another one. And it's very interesting. It makes for complications and expense of building the airplane. And also there's a fitting somewhere, maybe on each engine cowling, that might be simpler, or could be somewhere near the APU. I don't know about aircraft design and construction very much, but all that interconnection can easily be supplied by a start cart. As a matter of fact, our start cart that you see in all of my videos, most of my videos, starting gas turbine engines, it is the same engine. It's a Garrett GTC 85, I think dash 27. Anyway, that particular engine is the APU in a 727, or was, I guess, because there's not many 727s flying around anymore. It's the same thing, the same engine. It's just on wheels. It has a connection on the outside to hook a pipe to go to the aircraft and flick it, and it'll start anything. As a matter of fact, I don't think I have footage, but when I was in Oshkosh in 2020, anyway, I got to help start an F5, which has two connections for the two small J85 engines, and the start cart was a Garrett GTC 85-27 on a little wheeled cart, exactly what we have. They made tens of thousands of those things back in the 50s, and they're still around. So that's your start cart. So that's three different ways to use the same plumbing to start a big airliner engine. Okay, hang on.
Okay, that's the start cart winding up. And now Walter's gonna switch on the output air. That's the air starter. While to wind up the big engine. You can hear it now, a little bit. We'll be giving it fuel any second. There we go. Ignition. Now the big engine is burning fuel and turning. Accelerating. Still being helped by the start cart. Walter at the start cart there. He's waiting for the signal to shut off. There he is. Okay, the start cart's winding down, and the big engine is idling. A little different than the sound you hear at an airport, but that's a large turbojet being started at our test site. It's been running well.
Okay, here's a fun one that I forgot and added on, as you can see. In-flight restart. Now, this is one of the ones that people are most interested in, and it's probably the least ever used. It does happen. There are definitely switches on airliners and aircraft that allow you to do this. The reason it's extremely rare is an in-flight shutdown that can be restarted is quite rare. Very rare. As a matter of fact, let's see. Maybe you guys can help me with this. A lot of people know about cars a lot more than I do. And I always use the example of a Honda Civic, which I shouldn't, because I want to know, what's the most reliable car engine out there? What's the most reliable engine of all time? What engine never quits? Is it a diesel? Is it a gas engine? It's definitely a piston engine. I had a rotary engine myself as my first car. They're great. Rotary engines are awesome. I don't know if they're the most reliable. No, but what's the most reliable engine that just never quits? Is it a four-cylinder Volvo? Is it a Volkswagen flat four air-cooled? What's the most reliable car engine out there? And airliner engines are about 10 times or more reliable than that. So they never just quit. If they quit, it's usually due to a problem that can't be solved in the air and can't restart them. But if they do, one I'm not going to say common. One way that an airliner engine can stop running in flight is by accidental shutdown. That's either a fault in the aircraft, which is kind of unlikely, or it's a mistake made by the pilot. And that's extremely unlikely because pilots are very careful, very highly trained. They know what they're doing. And there's safeguards to prevent the throttle being taken to shut off position. In our test cell, there isn't. So if you bring back the throttle, not too quickly, but too far, oops, you shut the fuel off and it stops. I've done that myself personally. It's kind of like a, uh-oh. But anyway, on aircraft, there's a, like on the Sabre, I've got footage of that too. On the Sabre, the stick comes back. Now the throttle quadrant, the stick's here, throttle quadrant comes back and it, bang, and hits a stop. In order to get past the idle stop, you've got to make a spring-loaded lever go outside and back and in. And now it's the shut-off position. So you can't just pull it back. Anyway, if for some reason, not blaming anybody, whatever happens, there was a speculation on Blancalieri's channel about the Challenger? It's a twin jet that has lockouts for the throttles when they can be banged out of place in very rare sets of circumstances, and then you can bring the throttles off to shut the engines off. And the thing is, it can happen. In-flight shutdown can happen by accident or from other things. I can't speculate on everything. Maybe there's a water bubble in the fuel, all kinds of things. Let's just say the engine stops. And all the instruments say, well, it's okay. There was no whatever. Well, let's try to restart it. Okay. In a fighter jet that doesn't have onboard batteries, has a starter motor but not onboard batteries, now what? Well, you can, in various flight manuals I've looked at, there's different cases for different aircraft and different engines. You can get the engine windmilling. You have to start the process quickly because if your engine shuts off for, say, a fuel starvation, it's going to wind down. It's got a few seconds before it gets below starting speed. So if you're quick and you know what's going on, you flip on the ignition and give it a bit of fuel. As the RPM comes down, and it'll catch and it's going again, and hey, that was great. That was only a few seconds. No bother. I wonder what that was. I better not make a mistake like that, or if it was a mistake, let's just go land and look it out, look over what's happening. And that's usually the instructions, is land as soon as possible. If you're over the airport doing maneuvers, land. Get down there because somebody needs to look at the plane, know why the engine shut off. And if it was you messing around with the throttle, that's good, because you know what it was. But otherwise, they got to figure it out and make sure it doesn't happen again. Now, that's easy. If you're in the same plane and the engine quits, and you're like, oh, what? And you're looking around, and I don't know, pilots are very busy, and the engine RPM drops below about 10%. It's better if it's higher. But below about 10%, and if it drops to zero, if the engine RPM drops to zero, some aircraft have the capability to go into a dive, especially if they have enough space down there. Some aircraft, that will cause the engine to windmill up to a speed at which you can start it. Single spool turbojets, that's easy to do. Turbofan engines, which have a low pressure system, which is separate from the high pressure system. You need to windmill the high pressure system because that's the part that burns the fuel. And that's what the starter's connected to. And that's what the fuel pumps are connected to. Some aircraft you can, some you can't. Each case is different. But yes, there are, I've seen on an old 747, there's air restart switches. Now, I'm not a pilot. I haven't read the pilot's manual for the 747. I'm sure there are certain conditions under which that will help and certain conditions under which that won't help. So the in-flight restart using the airflow through the engine is it's a possibility, but it's a very complicated subject that I know very little about. All I know is you need to get the core of the engine, the fuel burning core, to at least 10%, 9%, at least 9%. And if you can do that, you flip on the ignition, give it fuel, and hey, you're running again. So it's an interesting subject. It's extremely rare, but it's there. It's one of the possible ways to start a turbine engine. Okay, we're gonna move on right now. Okay, before we move on to the subject of the day, the hydraulic starter, the combustion gas starter, I didn't mention one way, and it's just a combination of both. And that is that the little turbine engine that supplies the gas for the starter on the engine, on the main engine of the plane, it's usually started by a battery and a gearbox motor. Usually, almost always, okay? But not always. Okay, so a combination of these two. So I've only seen it once. I'm sure it's happened. I'm sure other planes have it. I can't say I'm sure of that, but I just did. I've seen it on film, and I didn't know what I was watching till I had it explained by a US Air Force crew chief. The F-22. Okay, when the F-22 goes to start by itself, there's no start cart, and you see this little jet of red flame go flying out the side. Okay, the F-22's twin engine. So you only see one though, but I remember. It looks like a torch. It just goes out the side for a couple of seconds, not long enough to start the main engine. What's that? Well, that is a combustion gas cartridge, smaller one, starting the combustion gas turbine engine that supplies gas to run the air starter on the main engine of the F-22. It's very cool. And what's the advantage of that? The advantage is you have independence of a start cart, right? So the plane can be anywhere and it can be started on battery. No big deal, because the battery only has to supply spark to the APU. And that's quicker. The cartridge is much quicker to spin up the little engine than is, say, a battery, like the starter on a car. Very interesting. That's another combination. And I just thought of another one. Oh yeah, okay, so the cartridge start, there's footage of this. Well, there's footage of the F-22 being started on YouTube somewhere. I don't know where it is. I'm sure you could find it if you're interested. There's another cartridge start method that's, I've heard people call it an AV-pin starter. I think AV-pin is the type of fuel. I think it's a type of solid fuel, I'm not sure. But anyway, it is, of course it's a Rolls-Royce thing. It starts the Avons in a B-57 Canberra. And, okay, so you got a cartridge of solid propellant. It's not gunpowder, not rocket fuel, but it's more similar to rocket fuel. And with this one, this is a very quick start. It pushes, you've got the a chamber with a piston in it, and the piston has a, like a threaded center. And there's a rod that looks like a Twizzler, okay? The piston is connected to the rod, and the rod goes through a gear train that has a threaded hole in it. And the fuel ignites, and it pushes that piston very quickly and very forcefully. I guess, I don't know how far, a meter, half a meter, a couple feet. Anyway, it does that, and the thread pitch on that rod turns that gear with great force. So it just kind of goes like that, and that's how long the power stroke is, and that will spin the Rolls-Royce Avon central shaft, which weighs over 1,000 pounds, to starting speed, 900 RPM, just like that. And you can see this work in, I think that's the type of starting, but the smoke happens for a couple of seconds in this video. I'm not sure if the video is describing that, but the AV pin starter It moves a disc with a threaded rod through a gear, and that gear turns the starting clutch, and it starts the Avon within about a second. B57 Canberra starting. It's really cool because it makes a lot of black smoke, and the engine's going like amazing. Okay, so now we get to hydraulic, and the categories are simple. It's a hydraulic motor. So the hydraulic motor goes through a transfer gearbox. It's usually, it can be on its own mount, like on the Olympus. We're going to see one of those in a minute. Or it can be mounted to the gearbox of the engine. And the hydraulic starter is a hydraulic motor that's the right power capacity and the right RPM to turn the gear at the right RPM to turn the engine up to starting speed. So the hydraulic starter, as far as I know, there aren't any on aircraft engines, mainly because hydraulic starters are heavy, but they're not much heavier than an electric motor. But you have to supply hydraulic fluid to it, and a lot, at 3,000 PSI, the one that I'm familiar with. So the Rolls-Royce Olympus has a hydraulic starter. It's a marine and industrial engine, not the flying Olympus. It's the same engine, very closely related, but it's not, the hydraulic system is not used in the air because it's going to be heavier. You need a prime mover, typically a big electric motor, a hydraulic pump, a supply of hydraulic fluid, and the hydraulic starter. What we do with a shipborne Olympus or an industrial Olympus is we use a high flow, high pressure skid steer. We rent a skid steer. We have one, but it doesn't have enough hydraulic fluid flow. And it's got to be 3,000 PSI. And we have to rev that thing up. It's basically a turbocharged diesel piston engine running a hydraulic pump with big 1-inch lines to the hydraulic motor. And the motor's only this big. The hydraulic motor is basically the power unit for the same gear train as any of these. As a matter of fact, in industrial situations, I have seen a hydraulic motor mounted right here on a big stand in front of the engine. And it was a hydraulic motor that looked like if it wanted to, it could turn the whole engine over. Like, hydraulic motors are greatly strong. Anyway, so I'm going to think for a second. Oh, there is one more. The last on the list. We're going to go mechanical. We're going to call it mechanical. You're going to like this. All right. All right, with Gloria Gaynor in the background. Ways to start a turbine engine. We can't leave out the most fun of all. Is it mechanical? The only one I know of is the J58 in the SR71. Get a lot of questions about that. For the first couple of years, they had a start cart that was two, I believe they're Buick Wildcat 455s, I believe.
Hey everybody, what I just said about that start cart is not true. The internet's a wonderful thing. I decided to check. Should have checked before. So you want to go to SR71blackbird.com and look up the AG330 start cart. It's very cool. I will post the link to this page in the description. But basically they were
401 cubic inch engines, because this all happened before the introduction of the 455. Anyway, they were great, and apparently they were later replaced with 454s, which is cool. But anyway, the Buick 401s were 400 horsepower each, and that does raise questions. Why does the J58 take 750 horsepower to start? Because we're going to take a look at an Olympus, which is a 38,000 horsepower engine, and it has a 45 horsepower starter. So from 45 horsepower to 750, what gives? Another one of the mysteries of the SR71. From the jet shop at Jet City Turbines, in front of a 1950s turbojet engine for a Sabre jet. Thanks for watching.